sell the green smarts. You sell the bomber fist. Now Big Jim is back for more. It's time for season two. Don't know what you're gonna do. Better sit down and watch it too. He's got a microphone in his hand. Little Jim is his left-hand man. Big Jim. Oh, yeah. Big Jim. Community Corner. With Big Jim. Got a microphone in his hand. Little Jim is his left-hand man. Big Jim.
This is very comical.
Community Corner with Big Jim.
Hey, we rolling, Jim? Yeah, we're rolling. Welcome to another edition of Community Corner with Big Jim. And Little Jim's working the camera for me today. Make sure you don't screw around with the mic cord, Jim. We want to make sure we had a problems last season where you didn't hear it or you're...
How you know that you're on access television.
That's right, yeah. That's right. Yeah, freebies from Big Jim. There. Yeah, no extra charge for the sound effects. We're at Ashwood Farms today. Now, I've been saying tulips. I'm looking, and I'm seeing lilies. So, obviously, I was mistaken. All right. As you can see, they are tulips. I mean, they are lilies. See, there we go again. I got Richard.
Richard Norris.
Richard Norris. He's the owner of this thing, and... Well, why don't you fill us in a little bit on what Ashwood Gardens is. Here, take the mic. Go ahead.
What we are is a breeding operation for daylilies. Daylilies have become a very big phenomenon across the United States, and it is spreading to other parts of the world, but it's mainly an American institution, if you will, a phenomenon. At one time, say 50 years ago, daylilies were just a flower known along the roadside, or perhaps known for a few odd orange or yellow, maybe some golden cultivars. But in the last 50 years here in the United States, hybridizers, people who breed daylilies, have created varieties which cover incredible spectrum of the color range, style range, and at this point there are 60,000 introduced, registered and introduced daylilies in commerce. Most of this is, as I said, occurred in the United States. It's our thing. Other countries such as Japan have as part of their national symbolism. They have the chrysanthemum. Other countries adopt a flower. I think the United States flower might well be the daylily. There are literally hundreds and hundreds of people who are hybridizing daylilies, and I might be one of the largest operations doing that north of Florida.
How many are in Ohio?
Hybridizing?
Yeah.
I would say there are probably 30 hybridizers in Ohio.
So the climate and the area is suitable for doing this?
It's very suitable for daylilies, yes. Okay. We produce a slightly different daylily from what is produced in Florida, and they're able to cross over generations faster than we can, one every 12 months. We take 2 years to do that here. And so they make progress faster than us. But the Florida daylilies have a problem surviving when they come up to this climate. They're adaptable to the climate they're grown in.
Right.
And these are, we breed them to be hardy.
You get four seasons here, basically.
Yes, that's
it's
correct.
Not all summer, mm-hmm. So basically.
Not by any means.
They don't get much cold down there, so coming up here, bad news. Bad news.
Yes, they come. For the most part, they've never experienced those particular plants. Have never experienced cold. They come up here in Ohio, and many of them just simply die out. At the best, they may approach the the level of performance of our Ohio daylilies, but we have referred to Florida as the Mecca for the world of daylilies. But there's been a recent movement, which actually got started from an offhand comment of mine, which I labeled Ohio as the Northern Mecca. And it's now being used, it's being referred to that way, and people are traveling here from distances now to buy breeding stock, to see the daylilies, and just enjoy the flowers. I get visitors here from all of the surrounding states. We've already had visitors from Texas this year, visitors from Ontario, Canada, the other side of Toronto specifically. But people who love daylilies will travel a very long distance to see something new and different.
Well, it's kind of artistic.
It is.
It's very much where, especially if you're getting one of a kind, where there's mm-hmm. really nothing else out there, like number 48.
Mm-hmm.
It's if you're a collector or you're someone into art, you would cherish something like that.
I have always been fascinated by art and music. I love art and music. But I have no talent whatsoever. I cannot paint, I cannot sculpt, I cannot draw a picture, I can't draw anything, I cannot perform. The one way I found that I can create beauty is through hybridization of daylilies.
So this is not really a hobby, this is a passion.
This is began as a hobby, but it's grown, it's a passion, it's grown beyond that, it is a business, it's at this point, essentially a profession for me. It is what I do year-round in some aspect or another. I travel all over the United States and Canada.
Bringing the lilies with you?
I'm usually not taking the plants with me, but perhaps arranging for shipment later on.
You got pictures, I'm sure you bring.
Yeah, we have a website. We have I have a slideshow that I do.
Why don't you get that website out?
The website is Ashwood. Daylilies.com, ashdaylilies.com.
That's pretty easy to remember, too.
It's fairly easy, yes.
Did you have to pay for that website?
Yes, I did.
So it's worth it then. Now, you can actually sell off the website if you wanted to.
It's not set up like an eBay with a shopping cart,
right.
But I have a downloadable order blank, and I have my creations. And what has caught the attention of a lot of daylily people across the country is that I explain the process of getting where I've gotten. I show parents of how I mated two parents together. This was the result. Then I mated those two together, and a further result. And people say that they can learn quite a bit from my website in terms of the process of breeding, and there are some hints there for people.
Do you sing to them?
I
whistle a tune or something out there?
I would do that, but I know that a dead daylily is just not worth much, and I would kill them if I sang to them.
I know I would.
Yeah.
Grandma in Corning loves me, but nobody else did.
Yeah. My grandmother doesn't even love me.
No.
She heard me sing once.
Somebody paid me $200 to the Trumbull Township Leo Club if I would quit singing on Viewpoint to Grandma and Corning.
I've not heard you sing, but I have a feeling that I can imagine it. I might throw in on that.
$200.
$200?
Went to the Leo Club and I stopped singing.
Yeah.
So I want to make a CD now at Christmas time, Holiday Tunes for the In-Laws.
Hmm.
And I think it would go great. You know, maybe I can get a picture taken with the lilies behind me for the cover of it. So they're going to think it's beautiful music.
Uh-huh.
And then when they hear me, they're going to go to your website and really get on you for doing that.
Is that right?
Yeah. Well, enough of that. Listen, so you don't sing or whistle.
Mm-mm.
What do you do when you're out with the flowers here? Do you have to water them or just the rain take care of that?
For the most part, these things are so tough that the rain takes care of them. Most of the plants out into the fields, which we can't see at the moment.
We're going to take a ride there.
We're going to take a ride. We're going to get out there. Those plants may never have had a watering except for the first time after they were planted.
Wow.
In all the years interim. These plants are capable of growing into almost desert conditions, and they can grow at the edge of a pond with their feet wet. They're the most versatile plant you can imagine. They can grow from mid-Florida clear up into Alaska. Very, very wide range. And their color range is unbelievable.
Right.
If you wish to, we can go over and look at a truly unique daylily. It is the first daylily ever anywhere to show the turquoise coloration.
Oh, we'll have to go right there from here then.
I think we could go over there.
As a matter of fact, why don't we go ahead and how big is this farm?
The whole acreage is 40 acres, but we only use about six or seven of them for the plantings, and that's not solid. So it's a couple of acres of daylilies is what we kind of figure, yes.
All right,
so something on the order of about 50,000 total plants that would be here.
Now, these are Jim's just showing over here.
Mm-hmm.
Pan right over there real quick, Jim. Make sure your hand's not on the mic cord, though. Yeah. Little Jim always tackles the mic. These are for sale.
These are for sale. They're a mixture of my own introductions as well as those from other individuals. We're in the process of making a change here. I have always made my living, supported my habit, if you will, by selling plants that were hybridized and introduced by other hybridizers from all over the country. But I've hit the point now where I'm confident to go out on my own, if you will, and I'm only this coming year going to be selling the things that I have hybridized myself. So we're clearing out many of those plants.
So is it like a club of you guys in Ohio? Do y'all relay to each other?
We have a national.
Help each other out?
Very much so.
Okay, so it's almost an organization then.
Oh, there is actually a national organization called the American Hemerocallis Society. It has a membership of about 10,000. Of those, maybe 1,000 of those people actually hybridize. Very few more than just a little dabble. I raise a few seeds, just see what they get. Very few people do it at the scale that I do, putting out as many as 25,000 plants, experimental plants each year, seedlings we call them.
That's a lot.
It's a lot of work.
25,000.
25,000. Each one of those is hand planted on my knees.
Okay. So this almost sounds like it's a real hectic you could get really discombobulated over doing something like this. But something tells me you got a down pat to a simple science, and we're gonna make a lily later.
Mm-hmm.
We're gonna name it my wife's name, Shelly. I'm not gonna use Big Jim this time. My head's this big. I gotta calm it down a little bit. We're gonna put Shelly on as its name. We don't know if it's gonna work or not, but we're gonna try.
We can give it a try.
I'll stay in touch with you, and you can let me know how Shelly's doing.
Okay.
And I'll let you know how Shelly's doing.
Mm-hmm.
She's told me, behind every good man stands a good woman.
Mm-hmm. True.
She reminds me of that every day.
Mm-hmm.
So, it's a good thing to say to your wife once in a while.
She knows it.
Yeah.
I remind her of that.
All right, Jeb, you ready to take a little cruise around and look at some of these lilies? And we're going to hit the golf cart. And let's take a look. Let's take a gander at some of these lilies, all right?
A gander. There's a good word.
A breakthrough occurs. There's a hint.
This is a turquoise coloration, which has never, ever occurred anywhere else. This is one of the rarest plants in the world in terms of a daylily right here.
Right here.
Mm-hmm. And you almost have to zero in pretty close to be able to see the coloration. It's there. It's not what we call a finished product. It will be worked with. We will breed and try to bring out that shade into further generations. We would love to see a truly blue daylily. This might help us lead in that direction.
Right.
A blue daylily would be, the world would be the path to my door if I could develop one.
Right. I like that one right over there too. That's kind of unique.
That's a pretty daylily. It's a good performer. I named that Joan Hood after the president of the Missouri Garden Clubs.
That one's over there, too.
And that's the same. Yes, we have a lot.
Isn't that beautiful, Jim?
Across there.
Yeah. Now, what about the purple ones up over here?
That purple one up there is an introduction also of mine. We call it No Blue Oxford. It's a strange name for a wonderful plant. It is one of the few large flower daylilies that reblooms aggressively. Most daylilies have one round of bloom, and then they're over. If the audience is familiar with the famous Stella de Oro, you'll see that planted in 1,000 places around Athens. It's a little tiny golden yellow, short, very small blossom.
I see butterflies. Yes. Right over there, Jim. Look, zoom in on the butterfly. Now, do they help with the pollen?
I wouldn't say they would help. It's unlikely the insects pollinate daylilies very often. It'd be accidental.
So what is the butterfly doing right now?
Probably looking for nectar. Mm-hmm. They're not so much of a pollen gatherer. We do get some pollen gathering bees that get in there, and in a bad year.
I just heard one go by my head.
Yeah. Yeah, and then it makes it difficult for us to do the pollination.
That's a beautiful butterfly. You get a lot of them out here?
A fair number of them, yeah. We're out in the middle of nowhere here, and all of nature. We see foxes, of course, deer and coyotes and everything.
So you got the names down here.
And that one is just simply
that one's
number.
T11.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
T11.
And then some of them have carried a numerical designation for years, and then when I finally decide that it's worthy enough to be introduced, I will put a name to it. Like this yellow one that you can see over there to the left, that one's now introduced this year as Polly Wally Doodle.
Polly Wally Doodle. Did you come up with that name?
I did. And anything that I name, I have to come up with myself.
Now, do you get a patent for all these?
It's not a patent. It's a registration. Gives me rights to that name, and that's about it. Once I sell it, anybody else can use it, sell it, throw it away, whatever they want to do.
Right.
Yeah, they have all the rights.
All right, so now when you sell these, do you sell like one plant or do you sell like a group of them? How does it work?
A sale of a daylily, when it's introduced, will usually only be one, we call it a fan. Okay. Now this is made up of numerous fans.
Okay.
Right there. This is a single fan right here. So when I introduce this,
look at all the look at all the lilies on that one.
Mm-hmm.
There's some that haven't even bloomed yet. So they take the one back with them. Well, they probably buy more than one, right?
Usually, yes.
They can combine and mix what they want, which kind of goes to what you're doing.
Mm-hmm.
So when they get like this yellow one or this one here, and they take them home, they kind of blend together and make their own one, right?
They can if they choose to do that. Most people will just enjoy them as they are. The vast majority of people do not bother to try to create their own varieties.
And they just spread out every year.
And they will just spread out, the clumps will get larger. The clumps down in this area are essentially just a few fans. The more mature area you can see up there.
Yeah, a lot thicker.
Are much thicker, yes. I would like to show you a blossom over here and talk about where we
okay.
got the name.
All right, little Jim already tried one of these apples right here. And, Richard told him they weren't ready yet. Jim had to find out the hard way. All right, why don't you explain a little bit what's going on over here?
We're talking about naming daylilies, and this particular plant right here, which has already won a national award, I introduced in 2002 to Commerce. It's named Mary Lightfine. Mary Lightfine was a former student of mine. I taught in Perry County at Miller High School for 32 years.
Okay.
Mary Lightfine graduated clear back in 1972 and went on to Hocking Tech to get a nursing degree. Became very frustrated with the problems in American medical care. And she decided, I want to provide something to other people. And she volunteered with a program called Doctors Without Borders. Became very important to Doctors Without Borders. 1999, Doctors Without Borders, received the Nobel Peace Prize.
Wow.
When they received it, Mary was one of the named people. They singled her out as being one of the people of great importance to that organization. She now travels the United States lecturing in colleges as a Nurse Without Borders. Life magazine in 99 did a 7-page article on our local girl, Mary Lightfine, and her work. She took pictures of her voluntary nursing in Africa. She's volunteered in Kosovo, Somalia, Honduras for the hurricane relief there. She was one of the first people into Afghanistan after the troops.
Wow. Right,
yes. And when I read the article about her, I did not know at that point what an illustrious positive effect she'd had on the world. And I contacted her. I was able to Google her and find her down in Florida and told her, I want to name a daylily in your honor. And she was very pleased. I think sometimes she...
Has she seen one yet?
Oh, yes. Yep. She has grown it. She's got some at her home.
Fantastic.
And we've also, I've donated some. A retired undercover police detective.
And now he's doing this.
And now he is doing daylilies. Wow. His name is Dan Trimmer. But on the police force at New York, he was very well known because he had been shot at and missed more times than any other New York policeman. He was known throughout the entire force as Lucky Pierre.
Wow. How do you get to meet all these people? Is it through this, what you're doing?
Through this, yes.
And you just stumble upon all these different people.
We have meetings. There are national meetings. There is a national meeting that's going on in about a week that will be on Long Island. And it has already 620 registered attendees, and
it's turning away.
I will not be able this year. I can't afford the time to be away from here. My hybridization is the passion. It's the reason why I'm.
Have you gone before to anything?
I went to the national last year. It was in Cincinnati.
Okay. A little bit closer for you then.
Yeah. This year we have a regional. There are 18 regionals also. We have 18 regions, and that will be up in the northern part of Ohio. So I will be attending that one,
wow.
But I can't afford to attend all of the meetings.
Okay. Now, without looking, just stay right there. How many petals are on a standard lily?
That was a very good question, Jim.
Yeah.
There are three petals, and there are three sepals.
One. All right, ready, Jim? One, two, three.
Mm-hmm.
Those are the petals.
Mm-hmm.
These are the sepals?
Sepals.
One,
mm-hmm.
two, and three. On both of those is the same.
Yep, and you will find that on almost every single daylily. That's the standard lily form.
That's a trademark.
It's very interesting that you brought that point up because you will remember the introduction that I talked about called Polly Wally Doodle.
Right.
Okay, as everybody knows, the word Polly means extra or more or large number. Polly Wally Doodle is one of the very first daylilies that regularly will have not three and three, but four and four.
Do we have any here today?
Then? We should be able to find them.
Fantastic.
Yes, we can. If not that, another future introduction. Polly teepled daylilies, we call them, are one of the newest things that people are looking for. And they will go way out of their way to get a different face.
And a Polly Wally Doodle looks like the one that I would want to get.
Mm-hmm.
If there's four of them, so.
Yeah.
Hey, right, why don't we run over to the golf cart? And he's got thousands, 25,000, I think he said. 45,000 lilies that we're going to go gander at right now. What are we out for time, Jim?
26 minutes.
Yeah? Well, we're going to grab another tape because I ain't coming back before an hour. All right? We're going to go see some more lilies. Hey, he likes amusement rides.
That's pretty much that way here.
All right. Now we're going down. Now, what are these right over here?
These are all...
On this way. Yeah, that's right, Jim.
These are all varieties that were introduced by other people that I bought anywhere from a few years ago to 10, 12 years ago. and all of them are nationally distributed, known flowers. Many of them are...
Stop right there. Look at this red one right here next to us, Jim.
That's beautiful. What's the name of that one?
That one is Cherokee Star.
And, wow.
Yeah. Isn't that a beautiful,
beautiful
shade of red?
You know, that kind of reminds me like of a Grateful Dead tie-dyed T-shirt color. But that's it just stands right out compared to the other ones.
You need clarity of color is one of the things that we have to work at the most. But we also are trying to look for size right up here. See the size of that flower?
Yeah, yeah. What about this one over here? That looks like a jungle thing over here.
Right here?
No, right over there. What's that?
I'm not sure
lilies?
Which one. This here?
Yeah.
Oh, that is a tall grass.
Oh, okay.
Just simply called Miscanthus.
And people put that in their gardens?
Oh, yes, absolutely. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, beautiful landscape.
What would the source, why would you want that in your garden if it doesn't flower?
Look at the arcing foliage there, adds a little extra height, breaks up the flatness that you get with a daylily garden only. If you only have daylilies in there, you get a lot of color, but you don't have height. You don't have, there isn't much white, and this puts a little white.
Right.
Also puts some green in there. You really, for a garden, you have to have a variety of things.
And that would cover some shade, too, I think.
Yes.
Oh.
Yes.
Right. And what do you have that next to that? Lettuce?
Was it
cabbage?
Those are hostas.
Okay. See, now I have no clue what this stuff is, but that looks to me like something edible. But
you're welcome to try. Deer like it very, very.
Do they really?
Yes.
So you must sell a lot of that then.
The only thing we ever sell are the daylilies.
Wow.
That's all just our own personal.
For you. For you.
For us. That's right.
You get deer out here?
Oh, we unfortunately like the lilies. Yeah. Nasty little creatures.
So you got out, like you said, right over here is all different kinds of flowers. Look at all the lilies over there, Jim. Now, the majority of these look more of like a light color instead of a dark color.
From a distance, the lights dominate. You need to get up close in order to see the dark ones. They fade into the background. From a distance, most daylily beds look more yellow.
What's this?
That's another grass, very similar to the one. Actually, closer related to the one we were looking at a moment ago. Yes.
Do deer like that?
No, they don't. They leave that one alone.
Wow. That's why it's so big and full.
Exactly. Yeah. Okay. Grasses have become very popular in landscaping throughout the United States.
Right.
Right.
Now it's a profitable thing too to landscape.
Yes. Yes.
Well, now we're coming into some really bright colors. Look at that one right there, Jim, the front, little purple.
Yeah.
Isn't that gorgeous? What do you know the name of that one by?
This would not have a name. These are all daylilies, which I have hybridized myself, that are being evaluated. The vast majority of them.
All right, no, stop.
That one's kind of reminds me of a pumpkin color, the yellow there.
It is. It's very much in that range.
What's the name of that?
No name whatsoever.
So these are in
unnamed.
All right, they're rookies.
Rookies, yeah. Most of them will not make the grade.
So what do you do with the ones that don't make the grade?
The ones, I don't want your listeners
to
break into tears, but because we have only limited area here, most of the plants at the end of three blooming seasons are tilled into the ground.
Really?
Yes, they have to be destroyed. I do not want my mediocre plants to go out representing me. I only want my best plants representing me. So I do not like to see them
go up. So you'll mow them down if they don't make it.
That's right. If they don't make it, they'll be mowed down and plowed in.
Well,
yes.
I hope that yellow right there. Well, yeah, yellow. I hope that one makes it because, to me, that's beautiful.
It is a beautiful, beautiful plant.
There's a little white in there, too.
There's a tiny bit of white that shows up right here along the edge, which makes it a little bit special. But I'll tell you why this plant won't make it. A daylily is named that way because its flower lasts a single day. One day only. So each flower you see here will be gone tomorrow. This was yesterday's. So in order for this particular variety right here to be valuable in a garden, there have to be lots of flowers. There have to be a lot of buds. And if you look at this bloom area here called Escape, there were 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 on that one. Some of them have more than that. What that says, this particular plant, if it were grown by a home gardener, they might not see it more than 5, 6, 7 days a year.
That's it.
And that's it, and that's not acceptable.
Right.
No matter how good the flower is, it should be there. My standard is at least 25 blossoms.
So you want 25 buds on one?
On one at the minimum.
Wow.
If I can go past that, then I am happy, and I try to do that as often as possible. Exceptions will be made in case the flower, such as we were looking at the turquoise,
right,
if it breaks something totally unique and different, then we can accept some faults. But otherwise, you come back and look at this plant in another 10 days, it'll be all gone. You just brown on the top there, green, that's not good enough. That doesn't make the grade, no matter how. And most of the plants don't make the grade. They're not proper for the gardener. The whole idea of what I am doing is so that gardeners someday will look at my plants and say, that one performs, it's beautiful, and it adds to my garden.
Right.
It adds to my yard. Yes.
Longer than 3 or 4 days.
Longer than, yes, 3 or 4 days.
Okay.
It's nowhere near.
So I'm catching on to some of this as we're going on now. I didn't really realize that you expect 25 flowers on each stem, on each plant.
That's something of a minimum. I won't say that every single flower that I introduce will have.
Stop right
sure.
Right up here on these.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I can see more buds on those.
Yes, you can.
Now,
yes.
It's kind of like a pinkish.
It's a nice shade of pink.
And it's got like a little bit of, almost a red to it. What is the name? That's right, doesn't have a name.
No name.
Do you think that one's going to make it?
That one will not make it, even though it has more buds. Once it was crowded a little bit, it ceased to have the ability to produce the kind of budding that we need. I think there are probably 12 there. So you can see it's still a short, it's a fair distance away from where we want it to be.
Now, is that a dye color?
It could be used possibly as a dye. What happens
because
is
I noticed your hand,
yeah,
when you got wet there, it had a little bit of red color to it.
Absolutely. And as I go about in the mornings hybridizing, my entire clothing becomes tie-dyed. It looks like something from a Grateful Dead concert.
Well, can you use that?
It could possibly be used by somebody.
Since mm-hmm. you're going to have to mow these down,
mm-hmm.
can you create something out of these for like dye?
I wouldn't doubt it.
That you could use in the community on shirts or something else, like you said.
It would need what is known in dyeing as a mordant in order to make it stay. It washes out as it is.
Okay.
Very, very easily. Like this shirt, these pants that I'm wearing right now, were all different colors before I'm being washed.
Wow.
So they, if something has to be in there to make the dye stay. Now, I'd like to take you up to the left, since we're talking about what makes for a good plant, and show you a plant that meets that criteria.
Okay.
And then some.
What's in the pond?
A lot of fish.
You got fish out there, you stock it?
We got bass and bluegill in there, and they're marvelous. It's a great bluegill pond.
Really? Oh, I'm going to have to come back out here another time and test my talents.
Wet a line.
Yeah,
actually,
yeah.
Actually, doesn't even take any talents to catch bluegill.
Not now. What's over here in front of us? It just looks like there's nothing grown there yet, I take.
There isn't anything growing at the moment. That would have been solid plants 12 months ago. And at the end of the season, we pulled out the ones that had made the grade, and then we plowed in the ones that didn't. Then we plant a cover crop. And cover crops are for the purpose of enriching the soil.
Okay.
So you can see the straw there, that was from a crop of wheat that was plowed into the ground. It enriches the soil. Now you can see little plants starting, as I just planted another cover crop. In another 6 weeks to 8 weeks, I will plow that back in, the soil will become a little bit richer. It's a sustainable version of agriculture. Farmers have done that for years and years.
Okay, now wait a minute. Right over there, are those what you were talking about before on the daylilies that you kind of see on the roadside, those orange things?
That one is actually butterfly weed. It's a marvelous attractant to butterflies. But I was just informed by nurserymen that that's on the almost endangered, semi-endangered species. So we have a fairly unusual flower here in southeastern Ohio. You see it everywhere in southeastern Ohio, but you don't see it growing too many other places.
Okay, come here a minute. Jim, put the camera over here for a minute. He's got a, bring your arm out this way. He's got a worm on here, and he walks like the inchworm. He goes up and down, up and down.
Probably is.
Is that an inchworm?
I would say it is, yes.
See him go up?
Definitely.
I'll dispose of him for you.
All right. You're not hungry enough to eat him, are you?
No. I don't like to kill anything unless I have to, and a worm has even got respect in my eyes. So we're going up on a pretty good hill here. Now, do we have stuff planted in here there?
We do have some ahead, and we're going to take a look at a plant that will illustrate what we mean by a quality garden show and the buddedness that we need for a long-term bloom and really impact in a garden.
What's all these over here?
These are all baby plants. They've never bloomed. They were from seed created this past year. And if we can get little Jim not to photograph the weed patch until I can get in there and weed it.
Well, I can't promise you it'll be edited, but how do you, do you have to recharge this thing every day? Do you go on it that much?
Country golf cart. Yeah. Even if I use it all day long, I can get 4, 5, 6 days out of it.
Well, all right, we're going over here, right?
We're
right here. All right, hang on a minute. The microphone in his hand, and little Jim's my left-hand man. That's my theme song this year.
Left-hand man,
yeah.
Okay.
All right, we're not going to walk in here.
Yeah, you don't want to be in the mic.
On this side.
Illustrate this. Okay. This is what we'd like to
be careful where you walk, Jim.
Daylilies. Look at the number of buds, the
most. Wow.
That is the kind of thing a gardener wants to have. I'm not crazy about the color of red, the shade of red. I like a bright red.
Right.
But the impact that this plant has because of the amount of buds, it also has a little bit of rebloom coming. So this
and lots of leaves.
Lots of leaves. They're good.
You look filler. Also, it's a filler.
Good, clean leaves.
Right.
Daylilies sometimes will develop a lot of discoloration in the foliage, and the better varieties will stay good and green and attractive in and of themselves.
Now those yellows have made it.
Those are yellows that have made it. That was named, that's named Ruth Parrish. I introduced it several years ago. It's in honor of my wife's cousin who passed away from cancer about 4 years ago. Very good plant.
Do we have any blue yet?
There is no blue.
We got to work on blue.
Yeah,
there's no blue.
Have you attempted it?
Oh, yes. But it's an extraordinarily difficult thing to do.
How many years have you been trying to make a blue lily?
Well, pretty well the whole time that I've been doing, most of the 20 years,
so,
yes.
So probably nobody else has one either.
No, nobody does. There are several people who every year publish well-photoshopped images of flowers that are blue. That are not blue when you see them in person, and those people do not have my respect.
Right, right.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. You can't be cheating the consumer, you know.
That's right. It is pure fraud.
Yeah. And you know, I'm standing here, and the smell is just gorgeous. They do have a fragrance to them, and they're all different colors is what I like about it. I haven't picked out the favorite one I liked yet. Mm-hmm. I know the yellow one back there that won't make it because it doesn't have the buds. That was in the lining,
mm-hmm.
and there was a bright red one over there, and also. The one that you named after the teacher there.
The purple?
Your student, right?
The student.
Yeah, the purple. That was gorgeous. So we're not done seeing them all yet, though. So look down here, Jim. What are all these?
These are in their very first maiden bloom. They were planted.
This is soft dirt here.
Soft dirt. They're in their maiden bloom.
Ooh, look at this one right here. That's gorgeous.
Actually, the blossom on the other side is much more attractive if you want to go around.
Run down there, Jim. And
they will vary from bloom to bloom.
Can you see that, Jim?
Oh, yeah. That has no name. It's just a newly numbered seedling that says that it will go to round two for evaluation. The vast majority.
Oh, look at those yellows over there. I don't know what it is. You know, they say when you get roses, I believe yellow is friendship.
I think so.
And I don't know what it is about these yellow lilies, but for some reason they're grabbing my eye.
Mm-hmm.
More so than the purple or the red. You know, it's like a pumpkin color on this one, too. Those are their eye. Is that what you want, something that just grabs your eye?
Grabs your eye from a distance. I've often been asked by people who don't hybridize or hybridize on a small, small scale, how do you evaluate 45,000 plants? And I tell them I do it from the back of my golf cart more than anything else. I drive by the patches of daylilies, and I'm looking for the one that jumps out at me and says, hey, look at me. I don't want to have to go in there and part the foliage and find, this is a pretty blossom. Yeah, I discovered you. No, I wanted to have it. It discovers me. It calls to me from a distance.
That's basically what it's been doing to me today.
And that's what we want.
Yeah.
In the garden, we want to have that sort of impact. Now, other people can go for the subtle colors. I like them bright. I like them bold.
Yeah, me too. Look at the scenery here that he enjoys. Just standing out here. I mean, that's just, it reminds me of New Hampshire a little bit up there. And it's all mountains up there and the foliage and everything. I bet you there's really beautiful color out here for you in the fall.
In the fall, it's just like being in heaven out here with the colors. I was born and raised in a little suburb of Toledo in the Black Swamp area, and if anybody's familiar with that, you could play pool anywhere on the in the area of Toledo. The ground is so flat, the topsoil is very, very deep up there, but I really would never want to go back to it. I love these Athens County hills. Been here now, we've been on this place for close to 40 years, and I have no intention of being anywhere else unless I must.
What about field mice? Any kind of damage that the rodents or...
Mice and other rodents are not a problem.
They like lilies and they leave them alone.
The biggest thing for the daylilies is the problem with the deer. They like to eat the flower scapes just when they're first coming out. I think they must think of it as kind of candy because they'll go up and down a row and just eat one right after another. That's why we keep a electric fence around here, which does a pretty good job.
So if I was to go over there and touch it, I'd get an afro?
That or worse, who knows? Yeah.
We're not going to do that.
Nah.
Little Jim might, but a little old for that kind of fun. Spontaneous, shocking. I think just watching me on camera, the viewers get kind of shocked.
They get enough of a thrill just... Yeah. Yeah. Watching you, yeah.
All right, now here's another question I was going to put for you. I thought it was tulips. So I want you to tell me who sang this song. It was back in when it was black and white TV.
You're going to sing, huh?
Yeah.
Can I step out of the picture?
No.
I am not sure I would be associated with it.
Pretend I have a ukulele. Tiptoe through the tulips. Who sang that?
I have no idea except for maybe Tiny Tim.
Tiny Tim. So I knew you're my age around there. And I knew you would get that. And that was going to be my big thing because they were tulips. But
I've got one for you.
Okay.
What was Tiny Tim's girlfriend's name?
Oh, man. She was well known to Twiggy?
Nope.
Am I on the right path, though? She was...
More or less. I was the quiz team coach at Miller. So we dealt with all sorts of trivia.
Useless facts.
Useless facts, Jim. So, yeah, okay. There's no problem.
Lay it on me. Who was it?
That was Miss Vicky.
Miss Vicky?
Miss Vicky. That's what I remember.
Okay.
Anyway.
I can't remember, but I do know he got married on some TV show.
Can you imagine?
Yeah. Yeah. And he sang tiptoe through. He had real long hair. He was a hippie-looking kind of dude.
He was an unusual individual.
Yeah. Wasn't he on like the Smothers Brothers or something?
I think he was on a lot of different shows. He was the big thing. Everybody had to see Tiny Tim there for a while. Yeah.
Tiptoe through the tulips.
Yeah.
Mm. Yeah. I used to tap my toe to that. Now you get a lot of turkey buzzards flying around here too, don't you?
We surely do. A lot of wildlife out here.
I remember seeing some film about woods. In Ohio, and at one point with the coal and everything going on, there was no trees.
No trees. Yep.
And they basically, this is all started from scratch.
Yep.
I can't remember how many, 100 years ago, whatever. But at one point, there was no trees here.
Any direction you would have looked here would have been denuded of the.
Check out the trees around here, Jim. It's just incredible that at one point you wouldn't be seeing any of that green out there.
Yeah, we really thought when pioneers first came here that the tree was the enemy, and we find now that the tree is one of our best friends.
Ecologically. I used to live in a kind of goof around in a tree house in upper state New York.
Mm-hmm.
I'm from Rome, New York, is where I was born, and we had a tree house up there, and if you don't have trees around your house as a kid, I think you're deprived.
Absolutely.
If you have a kid, though, man, he's in Wonderland. This is better than Michael Jackson's theme park that he's got there. You don't have any animals, but you got beautiful flowers, and you're not going in debt.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, we're not seeing you on court TV, are we?
No, sir.
No, we're not. All right, where are we going to go from here next?
Why don't we go back where we came from on that side, and there would be some, you like the yellows and golds. Let's go look at some good-looking yellows and golds.
Beautiful, beautiful. All right, this is Community Corner with Big Jim. I got Richard.
Norris.
You know, I'm bad with names. I'm bad with words. Richard Morris.
Norris.
Richard. I don't edit either now. All right, we're going to start all over. Ready? I love outtakes. This is Community Corner with Big Jim with Richard Norris. We're at the
Ashwood Garden.
Ashwood Gardens. Beautiful lilies. We're going to go check out some beautiful yellow ones now because he knows they're right up my alley. We'll be right back. I always say, are we rolling? And he gives me the thumbs up. There's a red light right there. When that red light comes on, that means we're recording. So I already know we're rolling. But Jim feels a little bit more special this way.
Oh, all right. He is
special. All right. Here, take the mic.
Okay.
I'm going to take my glasses off for these.
That's a very good idea. Your sunglasses will alter the color.
Yeah,
when you mentioned, Big Jim, that you liked this general type of color,
right.
The yellows and golds, I just thought of...
beautiful.
I think this is a nice one over here, too. I like my flowers...
It's got some white... Like in the middle, in the vein there, whatever. Mm-hmm. What is that called right in the middle?
That is the midrib right through there.
Okay.
And then we do have some veining. And then this particular one has what we call sculpting. It's almost as though it's been the product of a sculptor carving or a wood carver carving into it.
Yeah.
That was part of the reason for making this particular cross. Some of its siblings are extremely sculpted. So
This one here is opening up.
Yes,
will that be open tomorrow?
That's tomorrow's blossom, yes.
So they open one day, just kind of like these right here, too.
Mm-hmm.
And tomorrow, this will be gone.
Yes.
And that'll be blooming.
And that'll be blooming. That's right. That's right.
Wow.
And one of the
I never knew lilies only last one day. I bet you there's a lot of people that don't know that.
No. The daylilies fit in that category. The true lilies... are not. They will be blooming for multiple days.
Okay.
But these are not related very closely to the true lilies. These are actually more closely related to onions and garlic. They're not that far apart.
What's this in here?
That's just a weed mulberry.
Kind of leave it there for shade.
And just it'll be destroyed
when you mow down. These are all mow downs, right?
These most of these.
These aren't hacking.
Not all of them.
Let's count one of these stumps.
Sure. I see 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15 on that one.
So that's close.
That's in the right ballpark. If that particular one had something extraordinary in its flower, it might make it,
okay.
But probably not.
Check out that color right That is simply gorgeous.
Isn't that a nice color?
Yeah. And you have no name for it, no number.
No number. Well, no, that one doesn't even have a number. You're right.
I hope that one makes it. I really do.
I think it's beautiful.
Gorgeous, Richard.
I have a lot of others that fall in the category. That's nice down there, too.
I mean, these are just colors. That have come over here and look at that one right there. They just jump out at you.
Mm-hmm.
Jump out at you.
There's a
so
fairly good
one right there. Look how just beautifully, you know, we could take still pictures from the film and sell them for wallpapers on the mm-hmm. computers. I'm telling you, that's how beautiful they are.
I'd like to tell you a story of the plant right on the corner right over there.
That has not bloomed yet?
Has not bloomed. Late in the season, last year, the Athens County chapter, one of the chapters anyway, of the Red Hat Society came and I gave them a tour of the garden. And we were right standing over here, and this one was in full glorious bloom, a red with a white edge. And I told them, I'm going to introduce that next year, but I have no idea what name I'm going to use for it. And I looked over at one of the ladies, and on her T-shirt, it said, Red Hat Diva. And I said, I know what I'm going to name it.
Wow.
Red Hat Diva.
Wow.
So that is
So some of these names are interesting on how you come up with them. It's just not you pick it out of the blue. I mean, there's usually something that collaborates your brave thought, saying, oh, well, she had red on.
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
Some sort of inspiration.
And,
so,
and the student,
mm-hmm.
that was a big inspiration.
That's
what
right.
She's done. I'd like to shake her hand someday. She sounds like the type of person that I would like to know to get me to help.
And I named a daily No Blue Oxfords in honor of one of those.
Oh,
can put two and two together.
Well.
Don't want to see damage to them. Yeah.
Oh, I like this. Check out this one right here. That is just beautiful. Look at this right here. Isn't that beautiful? Yeah. You're doing a good job there today, Jim. We'll be looking at it for minutes.
55.
Okay, cool.
That's a nice one right there.
This one?
Yeah, a little bit.
Look at this one. Look how light this one is.
We have.
These are all the three. The three,
The normal, yes.
What are the ones with the four?
That was back up, remember when we looked at Polly Wally Doodle?
Yeah. It's
way back, yes.
Have to go up there, so.
That'll be good.
Okay.
That will be good. We have daylilies in almost every color. We can get some almost pure white, near white we call them. We have some that have a little bit of blue, as we saw the turquoise, and that's about it.
It's kind of like albino.
You could go that direction.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Ooh, look how bright and vibrant this one is right here. Now, folks, you're never going to see these again, I think, because there's a good chance he's mowing them down. So this is our really lucky day to actually get this on film, because some of these may not ever be around again.
That is absolutely true.
You know, to me, they're gorgeous, but to him, they're not super to the point where he wants to put his name behind them. And, you know, that's a good thing. That you just don't throw anything out there for the money. This is a passion for you. It's, well, I'm sure you enjoy the money coming in when you sell it. Everyone does. But at the same time, if it's got, you're like George Foreman.
Mm-hmm.
If my name's on it, then it's got to be good.
That's the way I feel.
Yeah.
Notice the whiteness that is getting into that. I think it's a wonderful combination of the yellow and the white together.
Yeah. That's nice. Those purples over there. It's like a lilac almost.
I'd love to tell the story of that daylily, which will not be introduced, but it does have something of a history. One time about 4 years ago, a lady showed up to buy daylilies here from over, I believe around Coshocton, Cambridge, excuse me. and she had her mother with her. And they came to the edge of my sales bed, and the daughter went in and started selecting some dahlias to take home. And the mother stood on the edge and said, "I'm not interested in this. I don't like daylilies." Okay, it's fine.
How could you not?
So we let that lie. Her daughter was very enthusiastic, and we took a ride in the golf cart. And that one was just a baby. It had one or two fans to it at that time.
The purple and the white.
That's right. I picked a single flower of that, and I handed it to the mother. And we rode at a four-seat golf cart at the time. She was sitting behind me, and I heard her about 10 feet down the path said, "This is beautiful." We went a little farther, and she said it again. And by the time we got back up to the house, and we have the bench where I was sitting, she sat there, and all she could do would be to stare into that flower, and say, "This is beautiful." And I got an email from her daughter later that day. She said, "Mother's going to tear up her perennial bed, and she's going to plant daylilies."
Beautiful. you couldn't ask for a better ending to that.
Mm-hmm.
Fun.
Yeah. What fun.
They're just, you know, so it's a shame that they're not going to make it.
But they have to.
But you know what? For a season, you got to look at them.
Actually, this would be third season for these, yes.
You're seeing, mm-hmm. So they yep. have a chance still. They could be here another year.
Definitely. Some of these will make it. Some will be pulled out. The best will be pulled out, yes.
We'll be at mm-hmm. a minute, sir, Jim. While we go ahead and we got to change tapes here. Bring it up here. To change tape, a little bit more to go here. Show us some kind of a process, I believe, on making one of these,
mm-hmm.
you know, creating it. And I think that's how we're going to end the show, but I definitely want to get the four petal one. So why don't you kind of like zoom in on one of these and fade it off on one of these beautiful flowers, Joe. We were walking through there and was talking about damaging some of these, hopefully not when I walk by. You told me these are 98% water?
Absolutely, yes. And the Chinese have been using daylily buds as a food for many, many years. Most of the audience has probably eaten daylilies without knowing it, because it's one of the essential ingredients in hot and sour soup.
Stop right here. You're going to focus in on these. These kind of like pink, or what kind of color would you call that?
Kind of a rose pink. That one is a named variety from a gentleman in Florida. It's called Altered State.
It's got the yellow in the heart of it, and then branches out with that beautiful rose color.
A darker rose eye area, and then the petal area is a rose, and then it has that light, pink perhaps, wide banded edge. Yes, that's actually a well-known daylily. It's grown most all over the United States, yeah.
So that one will last here with you, right?
That one will be dug and kept, as is this one. This is a famous daylily right here called Vatican City.
The purple one?
Yes.
Oh, yeah, I can see that color being called that.
Mm-hmm. The gentleman who hybridized that is up in Avon, Ohio. He's been hybridizing daylilies for 50 years.
Wow.
He's extremely successful, well-known, yes.
So you're almost a student of his, then.
I am.
He's done that that long.
That's right. I would call him my mentor. His name is Steve Moldovan.
Okay, great. Now, we're going to go up here, and you're going to show me kind of like how you get things together here.
Absolutely. We'll do that.
So they can figure out that there's some kind of a process to this. You just don't drop a seed, cover it up with dirt, and put your hands together and pray.
No, it's a pretty simple process, but it's long and it takes attention to detail, and I'll explain it when we get up there. The physical process of making a cross-pollination is...
All right, hang on a minute here. Jim, look over here and you can see some pigeons. What do you do with the pigeons?
I race these pigeons. These birds that you're seeing right there will be by October, flying a 300-mile... race out of southern Tennessee.
Have you ever won?
Not first place in the combine. I win locally, but I don't win in the combine, we call it. It's a group of clubs against a much larger competition, but on the local level, I've managed to win a few times. And
any of them ever escape and get out?
Oh, well, they get out, they come back in. These birds will spend hours out every day flying around very vigorously, and I've had these birds down to Athens already this year, even though they're just babies, and they fly right back up here.
No kidding.
Yes.
So I can take one in my car back to Gloucester and then just let him fly out of the car, and he would come right back here.
Easily. Oh, yes. Easily.
Wow.
That would be a walk in the park for him.
And they go straight to the shed here.
Yeah. They might, if they're full of energy, they might circle the shed for a while, but mostly they'll just come here, they land, go in, because that's their home and that's where they want to be.
And where they're fed.
Mm-hmm.
So, right. And they breed, I take it?
They breed, yes. And we've got another breeding loft, which we'll show in just a moment here as we come around the corner.
Okay.
That might be worth the show itself, racing pigeons.
Yeah. I'm, as a matter of fact, I'm going to be interviewing a guy that releases doves at weddings.
Very, very interesting, yes.
And, I believe he has a donkey, a couple of burros up there. And we got planned for little Jim to ride one up.
Oh, that will make for a good show, yes.
I also think he's going to supply me the chickens to hypnotize at the Big Jim night at OU football there in Athens.
That should be a lot of fun.
Yeah, we'll get you out there.
Ah, good. Yeah.
We're gonna do 20 of them. And I want to make the World Book of Records for hypnotizing the most chickens at one time.
That'll be great.
Yeah.
That will be great. Well, we're back here where we started.
Yeah. Yeah, the little gazebo. Do you sit out there a lot?
Not a whole lot. Usually don't have the time. Between the weeds and the pollination and all the other work that needs to be done, I don't do a lot of sitting when I'm out here.
You know, that'd be a nice place for like a family picture.
Mm-hmm.
Sit right up there, maybe even on the steps with a little. Gazebos are big up in New England.
Oh, yes.
You know, I don't see that many around here. What I do see is people leave their Christmas lights up in their house year-long.
This is true.
And even up in New Hampshire, you would think, which has a longer winter, more snow. Mm-hmm. Hey, man, when it's New Year's Day, those lights are coming off.
That's the way.
You know, but around here, you go down and you think it's Christmas.
That's absolutely true. I see that everywhere I go.
Maybe that's where the true meaning of Christmas in July comes through. I don't know. All right, we're going to get out here, and we're going to look at a four-petaled lily. Here, Jim, you can cut. And we got another hybridizer. I said it right?
Hybridizer.
Hybridizer here. I believe your name is Sean.
Sean Rickley, yes.
I've got to meet you. That's little Jim working the camera. There's a little thing called Community Corner with Big Jim, and I like to get out and show people what people in the community do. And this has been really a wonderful day. I've had the fragrance, the color, everything's good. How long have you been doing the hybridizer?
Hybridizing.
Yeah. How long have you been doing that?
For 12 years.
Yeah. And what drives you to keep doing it?
Improvement, I guess. Improvement in the daylily.
Now, do you have to mow down like he does ones that don't come out?
I do. I compost.
Does that hurt? Really hurt? Because as I'm looking at it, I mean, I can see his point where you want volume. You want like 20, 25 buds on that one. And they're so beautiful, but there might only be like 5 or 6. So it's really not doing the purpose of what you want is in filling out. So you got to mow them down. But to me, it would be like, I'm a pack rat. I mean, I got shoes from 20 years ago that are still good, but I never wear them. Mm-hmm. You know, and so to me, it's kind of hard to think that you would mow down something so beautiful. But I understand why you do that. How many of you conjured up by yourself?
Just 4. I've introduced 4 into commerce so far.
Okay, and what are the names?
Oh, geez, I couldn't tell you. All right, off the top of my head. I could tell you one is Ruth Hannah Brown. It's named after my grandmother. It's probably my best one to date.
Okay. And that one means a lot to you then, I take it?
Very much, yeah.
How many petals are on a lily?
4 usually. 4 petals, 4 sepals.
No, it's 3.
3, you're right. 3 and 3.
And he's going to show us he's going to show us one right now that's 4. You want to come over and look at it with
us?
All right, come on. Hey, I almost got him there, guy. I almost got him. You know, I've only known this for 30 minutes.
You went for trivia.
It does sink in once in a while here, yeah. All right, now we got.
Okay. Some days this particular plant will have many of them. This time I'm seeing one down here. And
looks like this one right here,
that's
right?
The one right there. So if I can make room to come around. There must be. No, it's a.
You can look right there, Jim. Back up here. Come over. little bit more towards me, so your shadow's not on. There you go. There's a few of them.
And it makes for a larger flower, and it makes for a more interesting flower in many ways. There are sometimes it's pretty common on here. Unfortunately, it is not a day with.
Well, we got one.
We found one.
We got one. That's you know, not everybody can say they've seen a four.
Four-petal,
you know, lily. That's just that's
kind of like a four-leaf clover.
Yeah. There you go.
I have another one down the line that has it at a much higher rate, and it'll be an introduction for the coming year. This one is Polywally Doodle, and the one down there I hope to register as it's hip to be square, because when you get four petals,
that's right,
you get kind of a square look to it.
Yeah. So. Who was that? Huey Lewis in the News?
I think that's who it was.
Yeah. Yeah. I think so too. I enjoyed his music.
Big Jim, would you like me to show you the physical act of pollination and what it takes to do this?
Yeah, as a matter of fact, Sean can even join us because he does this.
He does do this.
And yes. He'll be able to see us try to create the Shelley lily. I like the sound of that.
It's got a sound. It's got a little certain ring to it.
Yeah, Shelley lily.
Shelley lily.
Yeah, maybe I'll be lucky on the not doing having to do dishes and maybe she'll do the wash for me and. She might do some stuff for me since I've done this, you know.
If we're going to try to create something that's actually worthwhile, we'll make us. And I will take the Polywally Doodle and I will put it on the future introduction, Hip to be Square. The genetics from both of them have this tendency to produce the polytepals, the four petals, and maybe with luck, that one will be a special one, have the four petals, and actually be worth going into commerce.
Fantastic.
So we will.
Fantastic.
Little Jim, if you want to zero in, I'll show some of the anatomy of the flower. Your listeners will need to be able to see the anatomy. If you want to come in closer, that'd be good.
Watch where you're walking
now. All right. Daylilies are what are known as perfect flowers. They have both the male and the female parts. These are the male parts right here, with the
pollen. Little things sticking up.
Yes, those are the anthers at the end.
Anthers?
Anthers, yes. This at the end, this is the pistil. The pistil is the female portion.
It's longer than the male.
Isn't it though? Yeah.
So that doesn't sound right to me.
Yeah. You think maybe God screwed up, huh?
Yeah. Are you eating that?
Could. But I'm going to take this, which contains the pollen, the male portion of the flower.
Oh, I see. You're actually starting on what you need to do right now.
Exactly. I'm beginning the process. And I'm going to take it down to the other polytepal. We're going to put the pollen on there. And with luck, we'll have...
Is the pollen that's up there on the edge?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. That's what's all over my pants.
Yes. You
look at my pants, Jim. Look.
Yeah, you got pollen.
See, that's pollen right there.
That's right. Now this is a heavy.
It's edible too.
Mm-hmm. This is, of course, bees gather this. That's their source of protein. The pollen of some plants, when blown in the air, causes the allergies. Like ragweed pollen produces that.
Dandelions,
things like that. I don't think that's much of an allergy problem, but we do get lots of pollens everywhere you look. There are plants that are going to produce a pollen, and without it they cannot sexually reproduce. They can produce by vegetation, but the pollen is necessary for that. So let's take that down there and we're going to put it on.
Hey, check this out. Shelley, baby, we're setting you right up. This is better than making kids. Yeah.
You can't count your kids in.
Well, can't fly the kids in. I gotta remember that one. All right.
Okay, what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna take the pollen here from Polywally Doodle. I'm gonna place that at the end of the pistil. That's the receptive portion right there.
Okay.
Now what will happen is there's a little bit of moisture at the end of that pistil, particularly in the morning. It may still be there because we have a decent day. Okay. If so, it will cause that pollen to break open. And the genetic material will flow down tubes that are in that pistil down to little tiny eggs which are in the ovary of that flower. And I'm going to show you the ovary of a flower in a second, but we're going to put a second cross right here. Going to put another one right on there. Now later, I'm going to come back down and I'm going to mark a tag to show we did the cross for Big Jim. We're going to see if anything comes of that.
Okay. And we won't know for probably a year, right?
You won't know whether it's good for about 5 or 6 days.
Oh, okay.
After that, we'll know that we are likely to have seeds.
Okay.
At around 45 to 50 days, somewhere in that area, I will have a walnut-sized and shaped seed pod, which will have grown with seeds inside that will eventually have these great, big, beautiful, shiny, black, BB-like seeds. Those seeds will be gathered. I will put that into the into an envelope in my refrigerator for a month.
Okay.
With the label of which parents they come from. Then they're going to go into my greenhouse to be planted, and they will grow all winter long. And then in the springtime, as you saw on the far side over there, as baby plants, they'll be placed out.
Okay.
A year later, they will bloom. And if we're lucky, the seeds that may be produced here could possibly have an improvement on one or both of the parents.
Right.
Yes. That the vast majority are not improvements. It's only occasionally that you get an improvement.
So this is how you actually create all your daylilies.
Exactly.
It's just like what we just saw.
What we just saw. And you saw that there's nothing technical about it. I've been asked many, many times, how do you do this if you were a Spanish teacher, not a science teacher?
Right.
They expect me to be a science teacher.
Or math.
Or math teacher, something like that. No, it's not high tech. It is merely a matter of stick-to-itiveness. It's a lot of work. It's a lot of record keeping.
And time consuming.
Time consuming, and it requires patience.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
Fortunately, 32 years in the classroom, believe me, I got patience.
Yeah. I have no patience. Now, I'm hearing like birds and stuff. Do the birds really kind of like come around all these two?
They're not a particular attractant to the birds. The birds, you largely ignore them. The Japanese beetles don't pay much attention to them. There are almost no insect pests to them, almost no diseases that are relevant whatsoever. They grow almost despite whatever you do to them, a daylily will grow. I'll tell you a story that happened right out there years ago when I started here. I was dividing a piece of a daylily for planting out for sale. And I dropped it on it. It was about 4 fans together. It was right around the 1st of August. At the end of August, which had been a very hot, dry month, I found that plant. It had been lying in the full sun. It had turned into what looked like leaf litter. I took that plant, I planted in it, and bloomed the following year.
No kidding.
Not only lived, it bloomed.
Wow.
They are tough. All of the daylilies that we see growing so-called wild around the highways, none of those are native. Those are not native. In fact, they were brought back from China by Marco Polo, is the best guess.
No kidding.
Brought back by Marco Polo, they became one of those popular flowers in Europe. These are not the lilies that are referred to in the Bible, the lilies of the field. Lilies of the field are the true lilies. The daylilies were brought back there. They became very popular. They came over on very likely the Mayflower. If not, then the later ships. They were grown. Almost every household in England had their daylilies. They did eat them, but they mainly used them for show. When they came west, it was one of the things that every housewife had to have, a start of her wild daylily.
Right.
They planted them next to the homesteads. They were there in perpetuity because they're not going to die. They just are going to keep living. When the highway department came along and bought the homestead, they took that, the homestead, bulldozed it down, and used that as fill beside the road. That didn't kill the daylilies. They popped up, and there they are growing. Every spot you see along the highway where the daylilies are growing, that was where a homestead was bulldozed. That's some pioneer woman's stock of plants. And an interesting thing about it is every single one of those along the road is actually the same plant. They're all clones of one another.
Wow. Now, is it easier now to do what you just did, to cross-pollinate and everything, compared to when it was when you first started out?
When I first started, I'm smarter about it. There's no doubt. I've learned, yeah. But to illustrate, a gentleman by the name of Dr. Arlo Stout at the New York Botanical Garden took the roadside daylily, which is almost completely infertile. And he's a hero to us because he made something on the order of 20,000 of those pollinations right there, hand-marked every single one of them, and ended up with 6 seeds.
You're kidding.
6
Wow.
seeds. That was the breakthrough, to find the genetics of that daylily, bring it into the gene pool. There are other species that are a little more fertile, but they wanted the characteristics in that daylily because you know how tough it is. And they brought it in. By way of those 6 seeds, that much effort, 20,000 pollinations.
That's incredible.
Yeah.
Okay, I'm going to close this up. How can they get in touch with you if they want to, you know, get one of these beautiful lilies that you have here for sale? Kind of give us some contact information here and what you can do to assist them.
Anybody that wants to come out and see the daylilies would be most welcome. Please realize this is the last year that we will have the wide variety will be pretty well exclusively mine. And I will warn you that when daylilies are new to commerce, they do command a fairly high price. So for the average gardener, these may or may not at this point be their first choice. But if they wish to contact me, come out, I would be very welcoming. AshwoodDaylilies.com, we spelled it out earlier, and that's easy to go to the...
Yeah, I'm going to put it in print at the end of the show, too.
Excellent.
And what about your phone number?
Phone number? I'd rather not give that out.
Okay, then just go through the Internet.
Just go through the Internet, that's
now,
right.
Now, can you do like... school kids coming out for a little tour? Can you do something like that?
Usually not school kids because this time of the year is the bloom season.
So really they're in school when it's not. So
that's right.
Kind of doesn't collaborate with
what
you.
What we do is...
you being an ex-teacher and everything, it's too bad you can't blend the two together.
It is. But we've had master gardeners groups. We have garden clubs. And I love to have families with little children because I take them through the process and show them the flower and its anatomy and how the pollination takes place.
Okay, so if they're interested in grabbing one of these, we'll put it up there at the end of the show here in text so they can get in touch with you. And I really had a fun time and I learned quite a bit today.
Thank you
very much for letting little Jim and I come out. Mm-hmm. This has been Community Corner with Big Jim. You can put it on him again. We got the man here at the
Ashwood Garden.
Ashwood Gardens, and we've seen some beautiful lilies today, and we created, hopefully, a Shelley lily. This has been Community Corner with Big Jim. We'll see you next Friday night at 8 o'clock.
Community Corner. Featuring
Welcome
Big
to
Jim.
Another edition of Community Corner with Big Jim.